So hi everyone. In the previous lectures, we started with our discussion on the frequency response of MOS amplifiers. We understood how if I assume a single load capacitance at the output of your MOS device in three different configurations, whether it is in common source, common gate or common drain, we saw that the gain was reducing after a certain frequency. And we found out what is that frequency. And we also discussed a method of finding out poles and zeros in MOS-based circuits. Now I'm going to first, in the first half of the lecture, extend the procedures of finding poles and zeros. We'll slightly complicate MOS circuits, especially the single-stage MOS amplifiers, and try to find poles and zeros using this general approach. So just to refresh your memory, the approach we have been using before is if we have a transfer function S, we will apply the direct mathematical definition of a pole. And then we will apply that in a circuit to find what is the location of the pole. The definition is that the transfer function should blow up to infinity at that value of pole. Similarly, the transfer function should vanish to zero at the location of when you substitute S equal to SZ. So this is what we are going to, directly apply these conditions and find the poles and zeros of MOS-based circuits. I said that any MOS-based circuit, any MOS amplifier, it can, even a bipolar junction transistor-based amplifiers, can be reduced as far as the output is concerned, can be written in a general form as a product of transconductance multiplied by the output impedance. This GM here is the short circuit transconductance. The way in which we measure it, we short circuit the output terminal. So this is your output terminal, it is short circuited. V naught is made zero. And you apply a finite input and measure the short circuit current. The ratio of the short circuit current to the small signal input is what we call the GM of S. So now for a low frequency circuit, which was comprised only of resistors and dependent sources, it will not depend on the frequency or S, the Laplacian variable S. But for a circuit which is comprised of capacitors, we saw how there is frequency dependence of impedances. The transconductance will depend on the frequency, the Laplacian variable S. The next step is to find the output impedance. To find the output impedance, we short circuit the input, that is, we make the input go to zero and try to find the resistance looking at the output terminal. So how do you actually measure it? You apply your test voltage. Now you make the output voltage finite. You apply a test voltage Vx and try to find the current test current drawn from. So then the ratio of Vx upon Ix is what we call Z out of S. Now what we are going to do right now is apply these two procedures. We'll try to find short circuit transconductance and then short circuit output impedance. The product of these two terms will give us the voltage gain of the amplifier, the frequency dependent voltage gain. We already discussed once we have the voltage gain in terms of the Laplacian variable S, we can tell if the system is stable or not by looking at the location of the poles on an S plane. And we can also find its frequency response by evaluating the transfer function at S equal to J omega. So that's why we are keen on finding the transfer function. So now we just outlined a procedure to find the transfer function by finding the short circuit transconductance and impedances, output impedance, as a function of the Laplacian variable S. Now the zeros and poles of this gain, the gain function AV of S, the zeros and the poles will also be the zeros and poles of the transconductance and the output impedance. So you find the zeros and poles of the output impedance and the transconductance, that will be nothing but the output poles and zeros of the voltage gain. Okay, so that's what we are going to do now. We'll take a set of circuits, employ this procedure and try to find poles and zeros intuitively. Of course, you can solve by mathematically solving KCLs and KVLs at every node and solve it rigorously and find poles and zeros, which is entirely fine. But in today's times, you have software to do that for you. So mainly intuitions is what you have to learn, which you should be able to perform, estimate by performing simple hand analysis. Okay, so that's the whole goal of this exercise. Now I'll first consider a common source amplifier. I have just added a capacitor here. I've added a capacitor between gate and drain. So this is output terminal and input terminal. Previously, we analyzed the gain for this circuit without the capacitance. We saw how it was. Now I'm going to find the gain by considering this capacitance C. So for example, if I consider any capacitance, let's say I have a capacitance C1 here, will this C1 figure in the voltage gain of the circuit? Will this C1 depend on, I mean, will anything depend on the, will any parameter of the amplifier depend on this? Voltage gain, no, because the voltage gain, the voltage across this capacitance is fixed. The voltage across the capacitance is always fixed, so the current through the capacitor is always fixed. Okay, so that is in no way going to affect the output node voltage. Okay, so even if you take the capacitor away, this node voltage is fixed, the input node voltage is fixed. Okay, so now we'll employ this procedure. First, we'll find the short circuit transconductance. So to find the short circuit transconductance, I'll have to short circuit the output node. The moment I short circuit the output node, what happens here? The capacitance C is still present. The capacitance C is still present, and you have short circuited this node. What I'll do is I'll try to find out the direction I'm representing ISC in this direction, or I can change it as well. I'll find it. The direction of ISC is this. I'm applying an input voltage VI and I'm trying to find the short circuit current. Now, if the voltage is VI at the input terminal, output terminal is zero, what is the voltage across the capacitance C? One terminal is at VI, other terminal is at zero. So can I say the voltage across it VI itself? If it is VI, what is the current? Look at the direction of current I'm showing here. What is the current flowing in this direction across the capacitor? VI by the impedance of the capacitance. So it will be, I'm now we'll start writing it in Laplacian domain. So it will be VI into SC. That's your capital VI is the Laplace transform of the input. So VI into SC. That's your current flowing in the capacitor. Now, your MOS device is also operational now because VGS is finite. So therefore, the MOS device is going to carry a current of GMVI in this direction. So apply Kirchhoff's current law at this node. What will be your ISC? If I ask you to write ISC, I can directly say this current from the capacitor which is trying to flow the output minus GMVI, right? So that will be VI into SC minus GM into VI. So then if I take minus GMVI common out or minus VI common out, I'll get ISC upon VI will be minus of GM. So I'm taking minus GM common out. So if I take minus GM common out, I'll get 1 minus SC by GM. Is this fine? I've just taken minus GM common out. So if I take minus GM common out, this term becomes 1. This term you'll have to divide it by GM and you get a minus sign here. So this is the expression I'm getting for GM of S. So your GM of S for this amplifier is minus of GM into 1 minus SC upon GM. Okay, so the transconductance for this amplifier shows a zero in the output. So now, what does GMFS contain? Does GMFS contain any poles in the circuit? Does it contain any poles? It's a system with purely a zero, right? There is no real pole in the system. You can equate it to Z infinity. That will happen only at infinity. Only at S equal to infinity, there is no finite pole. So does GM contain any zeros? So equate GM of S equal to zero and try to find, does it contain any zeros? Yes, right? Equate this term to zero. It will be GM upon C. Is it a right of plane zero or a left of plane zero? This is a right of plane zero, right? This is a right of plane zero. So that's what you get. The next step is to find the output impedance. To find the output impedance, I'm going to short circuit my input and you'll have the capacitance C, RL and CL. So mind you, this RL here, even if I include R0, I'm going to club everything into RL and simply denote the resistance as RL here. So this also contains R naught in parallel with it. Now the capacitance C is between this node and the ground. So if now I want to find out the output impedance here. Okay, so the gate to source voltage is zero, so there is no GM component. The gate to source voltage is zero, so there is no GM component. I can remove the capacitor here and put it in parallel here. This is the same thing, right? If I apply voltage here, the capacitance can be put in parallel. So what is your impedance Z out of S? So can you quickly tell me what is the impedance? So you have RL in parallel with 1 by S into C plus CL. Right, this is your total output impedance. So by looking at this impedance, you have a resistor and capacitor in parallel. We already discussed in the last lecture that you will have a zero, or you will have a pole in this transfer function. What is the pole of this transfer function, of this impedance? Even before writing the expressions, what is the pole of this impedance? You have resistor and capacitor in parallel, 1 by R into C plus CL. That's it. This is your pole location. And we saw how to find it, right? Equate R equals minus of the total capacitance. So equate R equals minus of 1 by S into C plus CL. You will get this expression. Okay. So you get that expression for the pole. So you know the pole already, how to find it. So now you have some impedance Z out of S. You know the expression for pole, which is 1 plus S R into C parallel CL. This is the pole. It has only one pole. What is the DC value? If I'm writing a transfer function, I need to know the DC value. What is the DC value of this impedance? A DC capacitance is open circuit. So what is the DC value of this impedance? RL itself. So multiply it by DC value. So you have your transfer function. Right? We discussed a general procedure for writing transfer functions. It can be applicable to any transfer function for impedances, admittances, voltage ratios, or current ratios. Okay, so here I applied it for an impedance. We already know how to find pole for an impedance. Then I found out what is the value of Z out of zero. And since there are no zeros in the circuit, I can directly write zeros in the impedance. I can write it as RL by 1 plus S by S, 1 plus S into R into C parallel C. This is C plus CL. This is C plus CL. Okay. So now you expand this expression. Expand this RL parallel 1 by S into C plus CL. You will get the same expression. Okay. That's a brute force way of expanding it. Two impedances in parallel, you will get the same expression. So now let me write the overall gain. The overall voltage gain of this amplifier is given by the short circuit transconductance times Z out of S. So that is short circuit transconductance is minus of GM into 1 minus SC upon GM multiplied by your Z out of S, which is RL by 1 plus SRL into CL plus C. This is your total expression for the voltage gain AV of S. So I'll club the DC terms here. So DC term will be minus of GM into RL multiplied by 1 minus SC by GM divided by 1 plus S CL plus C into RL. This is your voltage gain AV of S. Okay, and this is the voltage gain for this circuit. The circuit with one capacitor C This was the voltage gain for this circuit. If C is zero, if C is zero, which means there is no capacitance, the circuit will simply reduce to something like this. You will have CL RL. Okay, the circuit will reduce to simply like this. Can you directly tell me what will be the voltage gain for this circuit? Frequency dependent voltage gain. See, always keep in mind, if you're trying to find voltage gain, look at in the previous lectures, because we didn't consider any capacitance from input to output. I'll come to that. I'll come to that little in probably in the middle of the lecture. We assume GM to be constant because in most of the cases, we just had a single MOS device. we did not add any extra capacitances to the MOS device itself. Now, the moment you add this capacitance, the current coming out of this MOS device will now be a function of capacitors. Okay, so that's why we are now seeing some frequency dependency. Previously, it was just a circuit like this. For example, the circuit was simply this way. So for this circuit, if I ask you to find the short circuit transconductance, it will be just minus GM. No capacitance, it was just minus GM. Now for this circuit here, it becomes minus GM into 1 minus SC by GM. Okay, so that's how you get this GM. I'll also give us some intuitions right now, but let me just first give you an expression. So for this circuit, the short circuit transconductance GM, or even for any amplifier, if you have one capacitor, at max, you will have one pole and one zero. That's it. You cannot have more than that. So you know the system has one pole, and you already know how to find the pole. So which is at the output terminal, you will see where the impedance blows up. That will blow up at 1 by RLCL. So the transfer function is going to contain a pole here, 1 by 1 plus S CLRL, multiplied by the DC gain, because there are no zeros in the system. Zero will happen only if the capacitance is short-circuited. Right, if capacitance is short circuit, the impedance of the output is short circuit, then you will have a zero. But that happens only at infinite frequencies. At infinite frequency, capacitance will act like a short circuit, output will go to zero. So keep in mind, when I'm finding the definition of a zero, input should be present. Input should be present, VI should be present. Even when input is present, output goes to zero. Even when input is present, output can go to zero. That can happen under two conditions, either when short circuit transconductance goes to zero or the impedance going to zero. Either these conditions will give the condition for finding zeros. So here, the short circuit transconductance is just minus GM for this circuit, right? We just found out if you short circuit this node, apply VI, you will have a current GM VI flowing here. If ISC is this direction, ISC will be minus of GM VI. No current will flow through this load impedance, right? The voltage across it is zero. So therefore, the short circuit transconductance doesn't contain any zeros. The other thing is, look for an impedance. The output impedance contains a zero at infinity, because only at infinite frequency, the capacitance will act like a short circuit and output will go to zero. So there is no real zero. So I can directly write the transfer function as the DC gain, which is minus of GMR times the pole, times 1 by the pole, 1 by 1 plus S. CLR again, okay. So 1 by 1 plus S by omega P. So I was just trying to say that. So this is the expression for voltage gain. Now look at the voltage gain here. The addition of this capacitance C, what is it doing to your circuit? What is it doing to your circuit? What is it doing to the location of the pole? Look at the location of the pole. What is it doing? Is it increasing it or decreasing it? It is decreasing the pole. Previously, it was 1 by RLCL. Previously, it was 1 by RLCL. Now it is 1 by RL into C plus CL. Okay? Why do you think that decrease is happening? See, previously, to charge this node voltage, if I want to charge this node voltage, I just had to charge this capacitor. I just had to charge one capacitor. But now to charge this node voltage, the current GMVI is going to come here, and it's going to charge this, it has to charge two capacitors together. Since it has more capacitors to charge, it's going to take a longer time to charge. So which means the bandwidth is slightly decreased. Increase in time constant means decrease in bandwidth. For a first order system, I had already told this very briefly. If I have a first order system of this type, 1 by 1 plus S by omega P, I can also express it as 1 by 1 plus S tau. For a first order system, the time constant is simply equal to 1 by omega p. If you know the pole of a first order system, then time constant is directly known from that. This is also equal to 1 by omega 3 dB. For a first order system, the 3 dB bandwidth is simply inverse of time constant. So I can say, if my time constant is very large, then I can say 3 dB bandwidth is very low. So I'll say if time constant is very large, I'll say it's a slow system. It's a slow system, which means your bandwidth will be very low for a slow system. If I say your system has very high bandwidth, it's a first order system with very high bandwidth, then automatically you know the time constant is very small because they both are inversely related. Time constant and bandwidth are inversely related. If your time constant is low, bandwidth is very high. So that's what is happening here. The additional capacitance is increasing the time constant of the output node. At the output node, now GMVI has to charge an extra capacitance C. Previously, it had only to charge CL, but now it also has to charge an additional capacitance C. That's why your transconductance is increasing. Your capacitance is increasing, so time constant is increasing, or pole is decreasing. The second thing to look at is there is a sudden zero appearing in the transfer function. Previously, we did not see the zero, but now we are seeing a zero in the transfer function. When do we see zeros generally? Whenever you have a transfer function, when do we see zeros generally? Now look at this. You're applying an input voltage VI here. The moment you apply VI here, if you generally in a MOSFET, the MOSFET is going to generate a current GMVI in response to that. But now because of this capacitance, there are two currents generated in response to VI. There is a current flowing from VI directly through the capacitor to the output. And there is also a current through the MOSFET to the output. So now there are two paths for the current. Whenever there are two paths, let's say you have some input voltage and you have two paths from input to the output. Okay. Whenever you have two paths, then you will invariably end up seeing zeros in the system. And of course, I'll probably make the definition more clear. Whenever you have two paths, with two different frequency responses, with two different transfer functions, frequency responses, then you will end up mostly seeing a zero in the output. For example, I'll take different examples and show you. Let's assume you have a path which is a constant gain, K, K1. In the other path, I have an integrator, K2 by S. So what is the transfer, overall transfer function? The sum of these two, add the two, what is the transfer function you get? You get K1 plus K2 by S. Now, when you add two functions, does this have a zero now? What is the zero location for this? Equate the two and equate it to minus one. So can I say the zero location will be minus of K2 by K1? Okay, it's minus of K2 by K1 happens to be the zero. So whenever you have two paths with different frequency dependencies, you will end up seeing zeros in the transfer function. Okay, you can have multiple paths, even then you will have zeros in the system. So this is one condition for zero. We will later see there are some other conditions as well. This is the most commonly encountered condition. You will see this in common drain amplifiers as well. We will very soon analyze them as well. You will see a similar condition. Okay. So keep this point in mind. So whenever you have two different paths, you'll have zero. So for example, in the second path, I'm going to modify this. And then I'm going to assume the second path is K2 into S. It's a differentiator. I'm going to put a transfer function, which is of this type, K2 into S. So the total transfer function will be K1 plus K2S. Now, what is the zero for this transfer function? Minus of K1 by K2. Okay, equate this to zero, you'll get minus of K1 by K2. So again, you are seeing a zero here. So whenever you have two different paths with two different transfer functions, frequency dependent transfer functions, you will end up seeing zeros. So that's what is happening in a MOS circuit. Okay. In the MOS circuit, what is happening in the MOS circuit here is that you have two paths to the output. Now, generally, when you find zeros, what is happening in the circuit is that you applied VI, a current is generated in the capacitor. I'm going to call it IC here. Okay. And you also have a current GMVI generated in the MOS device. Then IC is the current that's flowing through the capacitor, out of which GMVI flows through the MOSFET, and the remaining current flows through the output. Okay, remaining current flows through the output. Now there will be some frequency where this current IC will fully loop through the MOSFET itself. when that condition happens, when your IC becomes equal to GMVI, your Iout will become zero. So even though, even if I have some complex output impedance here, it does not matter. If this condition is satisfied where the output current is going to zero, then we can say you'll have a zero in the circuit at that value of S. So your IC here happens to be, because because if this current is zero, Iout is zero, you know, no matter what the impedance here is, the voltage across it will be zero. Okay, because your Iout is zero, so your Vout is Iout into Zout. Since this term is zero, you will get zero. Since you know this node voltage, precisely, you know what is this current flowing through the capacitor. So it will be Vi minus V naught, which is zero, upon 1 by SC, equated to GMVI. You get the location of the zero as GM by C. Since we get plus sign here, it's a right of plane zero. So that's what is actually happening in the circuit. The current that is flowing through the capacitor is fully flowing through this MOSFET itself. And therefore, no current flows through the impedance Z, so output is zero. So remember, this is only for mathematical analysis. Okay, so does this mean, see, I've said that the circuit here is zero, the output here is zero at SZ equal to GM by SC. If I plot the transfer function, let's assume I have a transfer function 1 by S by omega Z. We said it is a zero. In the frequency response, how does the transfer function look like? It looks like this. This is the Bode plot for the frequency response. It looks this way. We said by definition, remember Bode plots is for frequency axis. I'm trying to find out for some frequency, what is the response you get? You look at this transfer function, you will think that at omega equal to omega Z happens to be a zero. Shouldn't you be getting a zero here? Why am I not getting zero here? Yeah, that's true. So why are we not getting zero here? See, I said the mathematical definition of zero is when S becomes equal to minus omega Z, you get zero. But why do you think the transfer function is not going to zero at this frequency? No, because when you are plotting transfer function here, frequency response, you are plotting it as a function of omega. Okay, so if you substitute this, the zero is given by minus omega Z. So substitute S equal to J omega, you will get J omega equals minus omega. So the frequency where this occurs will be a complex imaginary number. Okay, that will be an imaginary number. The omega for which you will get here, this will be an imaginary number. Okay, so therefore you can't show this on a transfer function. You can't show this on a frequency axis. Then what do I mean? I mean, I use the definition that 1 plus S by omega Z is the definition of a zero. I used that definition and found out zero. So shouldn't the transfer function be blowing up? So that's where you have to understand that the transfer function does blow up, or it vanishes to zero. It does vanishes to zero. It does vanish at zero. But that happens on an S plane when SZ becomes equal to minus omega Z. So your transfer function H of S now is a three-dimensional function, because S here depends upon sigma plus j omega. It's a complex number. What we are doing, actually, when you plot your transfer function, it will be a three-dimensional function. You should plot it on a two-dimensional graph. You need a three-dimensional graph to show your transfer function. Remember, your transfer function is a complex number. So complex number will have its magnitude, mod of this. Again, magnitude depends upon two quantities. What is magnitude? It depends on omega. It also depends on sigma. But when we plot frequency response, we are slicing the transfer function along this axis. We are slicing it along this axis. So you can imagine the three-dimensional function to look something like this. So this is your, okay, so this is your omega axis, this is your sigma axis. What you are plotting as a transfer function is essentially just a two-dimensional, a plane H of S, mod of H of S equals evaluated at S equal to J omega. This is the plane you are plotting. The point where the transfer function actually vanishes to zero is here. This is minus omega Z. Okay, but frequency response is just the function will actually, if you draw the three-dimensional function, you will see some kind of a dent here. If you should imagine a three-dimensional function, okay, and you will see some kind of a dent here. Okay, the function will just blow up to zero at this point. This is how the transfer function will look like if you actually plot in a three dimensions. But what we are doing in frequency response is that we are just slicing it. You can imagine you are slicing it, this whole three-dimensional function along j omega axis, and you will get a plane here. You will get just a two-dimensional plane. That's what you are plotting as your frequency response. Okay? Or in this case, I'm showing this for a pole now. Sorry, the function should have looked like this. This is the function we are showing. So I'm sorry, this function will probably look slightly differently. So this will look something like this. It'll look, the function will blow up to infinity on either sides. They are not poles and zeros. Yes, so one of you are asking a question. So what are we actually plotting on the frequency response graph? You are plotting only the projection of, yeah, they are not truly the poles and zeros of the transfer function. Okay, they are not truly the poles and zeros of the transfer function. When I say poles and zeros, what do I mean? When I say a pole, it is the location of pole where the transfer function, it is the location of S, the value of S for which your transfer function blows up to infinity. It doesn't happen that way. For example, let me plot a simpler function, which is h of s equals 1 by 1 plus s by omega p. This one has a pole at omega p. We know that in frequency response, the graph will look like this, right? In frequency response at omega equal to plus omega p, this is minus omega p. This is how this graph is going to look like. But in three dimensions, it will actually look like this. It will have, let me call this as minus omega p as the left of plane pole. This is your transfer function along the j omega axis. The function will blow up like this. At this point, it will just have a singularity or a discontinuity at omega equal to omega p. It will just blow up. If you draw its function in three dimensions, it will look like this. On three dimensions, it will be a singularity at omega equal to omega p. But because you are plotting it along j omega axis, you don't really see it blowing up anywhere. On j omega axis, you don't really see it blowing up. What we are interpreting is that the pole gives us an information about the speed of the system, how fast your system. That interpretation you can derive from the frequency response graph. And that is the information we need. Okay, that is the information we need for designing an amplifier. We don't need this entire information. But if a question arises in your mind, we said the pole is the point where the transfer function blows up to infinity. Okay, so remember, I think one of you are asking a question, why are we on the j omega axis? See, j omega axis is, we are not looking at j omega axis. What is j omega axis? What is frequency response? I told you how to measure frequency response. Frequency response is nothing but it is the response of an amplifier to sinusoids of different frequencies. You keep varying the frequencies and measure the response of the system. And that is very important. You need to know that. Only then you can, because you will know what kind of signals can I feed to that amplifier. That's why you need to know frequency response. But it turns out, if you find the Laplace transform H of S and evaluate it at S equal to j omega, I get the frequency response. So that is why we first find the Laplace transform, and from Laplace transform's knowledge, we find the frequency response. So if you take Laplace transform graph and cut it along the j omega axis, you get the frequency response from it. So the question you should ask is, you should think, okay, frequency response means it is response to different sinusoids. If I feed a sinusoid of frequency omega p radians per second, am I to expect an infinite sine wave? Am I to expect a sine wave with an infinite amplitude? No, you don't expect it, because the frequency response graph is not telling you that. It's clearly telling you you have a finite gain. Okay, that's what this graph is telling you. So we'll slowly see, probably at the end of this course, I'll discuss when do I make the system? If I have an amplifier, can I feed some input? Can I feed some input that's going to give me an infinite output, an infinite output? Because the system has a pole. If the system has a pole, there should be some value of S for maybe some kind of an input, which should give me an infinite output. But I can tell you, no real input will give you an infinite output. No real input will give you an infinite output. Because if I try to find out using frequency domain, I get a condition omega equals some minus j omega p, minus or plus. Okay? So we get a complex imaginary frequency. So you will not have any real sine wave if you feed, which will give you an infinite output. Okay? So just keep that point in mind. We'll keep that thought in mind. You should have gotten the doubt that, okay, we derived it assuming poles and zeros, but why am I not seeing infinite? A pole by definition is a point where transfer function blows up, but it's not blowing up here. That's because it's a frequency response graph. It will blow up. Transfer function does blow up, but you should look at it in a three-dimensional graph that is shown here. There, in that graph, you will actually see it blowing up at the location of the pole itself. Okay? Blowing up at the location of the pole, it will vanish to zero at the location of the zero. So if you have a right of plane zero, if you plot the transfer function will look like this. It will vanish to zero here. Okay? So that's why you don't see it on frequency response graph. But is there any system, which will give me a zero output if I feed a sine wave itself? So can you think of an input? What kind of a transfer will the, can I have zero? Then I should have zeros on the frequency response itself. Do you see that? I'm telling you, can you think of a system which will give me a zero output if I feed sinusoids? Then how do you think its frequency response should look like? The frequency response itself should show a zero at that frequency. Okay, then I can expect to see a zero. So can you think of an example? I'll give you an example, 1 plus s by omega naught the whole square. So solve this equation. What do you get? What will be the zeros of the system? What are the zeros of this equation? 1 plus s by omega naught the whole square, 1 by s by s square by omega naught square, what is the zeros for this? Sz is plus minus j omega naught. So the zeros actually lie on the j omega axis itself. The zeros actually lie on the j omega axis. This is plus j omega naught and this is minus j omega naught. It actually lies on the j omega naught axis itself. So therefore, if you have a zero on the j omega naught axis, yes, if you feed a sine wave to the system at frequency omega naught, you should expect a zero output. Okay, so this is a real zero. Here, if you have a system of this type, that system has a real zero. You should expect a zero sine wave at the output. Similarly, if I have a transfer function of this type, 1 plus 1 by s by 1 plus s by omega naught the whole square. This system, what are the poles of the system? The poles are sp equals plus minus j omega naught. So the transfer function, if I draw it, it will actually blow up at omega naught. It will blow up at omega naught and minus omega naught. And you will see that in frequency response as well. You will see that the transfer function will blow up like this. The point where the transfer function blows up happens to be on the j omega axis itself. Therefore, you will see that in frequency response as well. Okay? And you can also see, substitute s equal to j omega. Sz is, for example, let's take this problem, is plus minus j omega naught. So I'll substitute sz as j omega equals plus minus j omega naught. So you get omega as plus minus, j and j cancel out, you will get omega as plus minus omega naught. So therefore, you get a real frequency itself at which your output will go to zero or infinity. Depending on the transfer function, it will go to infinity. Okay, so this is just for your understanding. I'll move on to a different circuit and we'll try to solve the circuits. Just to quickly refresh, this is fine. So if you've understood this, you can go back to this point and then think about it again and get back to me. But before that, this is our circuit of interest mainly. Remember, we are using these short circuit techniques to find out zeros and poles. It doesn't necessarily mean if I apply an input of sine wave equal to that zero frequency, I'll get a zero. It doesn't mean that. But the procedure we employ uses that understanding, because using that procedure, using the definition, we can derive zeros and poles. So what I'm just coming back to this circuit again. I said you will see zeros in MOS circuits if you have two paths, parallel paths leading to the output. In addition to that, both those paths should have different frequency dependencies. Look at this. If I apply VI here, one path is having no frequency dependence, it is GMVI. The other path is through a capacitor, so it has some kind of frequency dependence because of capacitance. So whenever you have two different paths, you should expect a zero here. At some frequency, this current flowing through the capacitor will fully flow through the MOSFET itself, and no current will flow through the load. So that happens to be your zero frequency. Okay, and we derived zero for this circuit, and I showed the transfer function. We'll take some two more circuits and derive poles and zeros for that as well. Okay, now this is a slightly different circuit. I wanted to take one specific example to show you that even though you don't have two different paths to the output, you can get zeros. So this circuit is to show you that example where you will get zeros, but you don't have two independent paths to the output. Okay, no, at least not explicitly. You don't have two explicit independent paths to the output. Okay, so now first we'll find out these poles and zeros for this circuit. I'll employ the same procedure. I'll find the short circuit transconductance, then I'll find out the output impedance. So first I'll assume lambda is zero in the circuit, which means R0 is infinity. So let's find the short circuit impedance. To find the short circuit impedance, I'm going to assume this impedance as Zs of S. Okay, and VI is applied, output is short circuited. I want to find ISC here. Okay, so if R0 is infinity, can you roughly tell me what will be ISC for the circuit? R0 is infinity. So what will be your short circuit current here? Transconductance reduces, right? Transconductance reduces by a factor. So now there is frequency dependence, that's it. So your GM will become GM upon 1 plus GM ZS, ZS of S. Your transconductance reduces by this factor, and we discussed why it reduces. There is some kind of feedback in the circuit, so it reduces by a factor 1 plus GM ZS of S. This times VI is your ISC. Okay? ISC is this. So the short circuit transconductance GM of S is given by GM upon 1 plus GM into ZS of S. Now step one, I need to find zeros of the circuit. If I want to find zero, what are the conditions under which this GM can go to zero? Either numerator should become infinity, or numerator should become zero, or denominator should become infinity. If denominator becomes infinity at some value of S, then I'm going to get zero, right? Then you will have 1 by infinity and you will get a zero. Numerator cannot be zero, it's a fixed quantity, GM, so I'll leave out the condition. The second condition is when denominator blowing up to infinity. First term is a constant, so for the second term to blow up, this term should blow up, which means from this I can say if Zs of S blows up to infinity at some point, then GM of S will become zero. So can you tell me, is there some frequency, some value of S for which Zs of S blows up to infinity? What will be that value? R and C are in parallel. See, whenever I'm asking in terms of S, tell the sign. So it will be 1 by RSCS, minus 1 by, it's a left off plane zero, it is minus 1 by RSCS. So you know that the product of R and C is a zero for this circuit. So that's how you found zero. You found the denominator blowing up to infinity. So from that you got the condition, the zero as 1 plus, minus 1 by RSCS. So is this a LHB or a right off plane zero? It's a LHP zero. Next. Next step is to find out the pole. To find the pole, I'll use the same definition, similar but the slightly modified definition. So you have gm by 1 plus gm into zs of s. How did we find the sine of 0? I already discussed this, right? If you have two resistors in parallel, impedances in parallel, the condition for pole is rs equals minus 1 by szcs. Okay? When this becomes equal to negative of this, you get the condition for pole or whatever, the point where the impedance blows up to infinity. So from that, you get sz is minus 1 by rscs. So this was discussed already, right? So you use this condition, yeah. Now, if I want to find pole here, so this is gm upon 1 plus gm into zs of s. I want to find out the zero pole for the circuit. Either gm should blow up to infinity or the denominator should blow up to zero. Do not, denominator should vanish to zero. Numerator cannot go to zero because it's a constant. The denominator goes to zero if 1 plus gm zs of s equals zero or gm into zs of s equals minus 1. So from this I can write zs of s equals minus 1 by gm or 1 by zs of s equals minus gm. So let's use this condition. What is 1 by zs of cs? You have two impedances in parallel. Resistor and capacitor are in parallel. So I can write impedance as 1 by r plus sc. The sum of the two admittances, right? Scs. 1 by rs plus scs. This should be equal to minus gm. So you can very easily show the location for pole is given by minus of 1 by cs into rs parallel 1 by gm. You can very easily show that. Take this term to this side, you will get this condition. Okay, so we found out poles and zeros of this transfer function gm of s. Where is the location of the pole? The location of the pole is at minus 1 by, so you have pole 1, I'll call it pole 1, cs into rs parallel 1 by gm. And we found it also had a zero, which is at minus 1 by cs rs. So we know pole and zero in the transconductance. So the transconductance will look like this. What is the DC transconductance? If I ask you what is the DC transconductance for the circuit, can you quickly tell me what is it? What is the DC short circuit transconductance? Just assume RS and tell me what is it? If I assume this as RS, it will be GM by 1 plus GM RS. Once you know the DC transconductance, multiply it with 0. 0 is 1 plus S CS RS. Right? Use this equation, 1 plus S by omega Z for LHP0. So you will get 1 plus S CS RS divided by 1 plus S CS into RS parallel 1 by GM. Okay? So I'm not able to fully show it there. So this is 1 plus CS into RS parallel 1 by GM. Okay, so I'll come to that little later, but that's not a very trivial, even if you assume it is in series, it doesn't very clearly tell you why you'll get, I'll come to that. I'll have an example to come to that, yeah. So let me go back to these definitions. So now you know how to write this GM. After writing the GM, the next step is to find the output impedance. So how will you find the output impedance for the circuit? If you're asked to find its output impedance, how will you find it? Short circuit the input here and try to find out the output impedance looking here. If you short circuit VI here, will there be any current flowing through this? Will there be any current to the drain of this MOSFET? We saw that, right? If you apply VI here, there will be some current flowing. But if there is no VI, VI is zero, this current is also zero, right? Is that fine? No current, right? I can say that this current is also zero because there is no VI, no current. And also you can look at it this way. I have assumed R naught is infinity. If R naught is infinity, even if I change the drain terminal here, will there be any current in response to that? R naught is infinity, there won't be any drain current response to that. So therefore, I can ignore this part of the circuit. I can ignore this part altogether when finding the output impedance. So quickly, can you tell me what is the output impedance ZL of S, Z out of S? We have already derived for parallel RC networks. By now, I can directly write it as the DC value by the pole. So it will be RL by 1 plus SCL RL. Okay? And the pole happens to be at the pole for this, at the output pole, I'll call it omega P2. It is at minus 1 by RLCL. This is the second pole. So now see, you have two capacitors. So you have gotten two poles and also one zero in the system. Maximum you will have two. Maximum, that only tells you maximum condition. Minimum, you can have zero as well. If you have two capacitors, the maximum number of poles you'll have is two. Zeros can also be two. Okay, I'm sorry. Yes, omega P is positive. SP2 is minus 1 by RLCL. Yes. So this is the notation we maintain throughout the course. Yes, you're right. Yes, for two capacitors, you can at max get two poles or two zeros. It'll always be less than that. So now let me write the overall transfer function GMFS into ZFS. So you have the total transfer function is GMFS into Z out of S. GM of S, we derive the transfer function GM by 1 plus GM RS multiplied by the 0, which is 1 plus S CS RS, and the pole, which is 1 plus S CS into RS parallel 1 by GM multiplied by the output impedance, which is RL upon 1 plus S CL RL. This is your overall transfer function. So I can club the RL and GM. That's your DC gain. So I'll call it GM into RL. This is your transfer function. So it has two poles and one zero. Okay. I've taken an example and showed you how to find it. We'll take the next circuit. Now by just looking at the circuit, can you tell me, will this circuit have a zero? This is the output terminal. Input is at this point. Will this have a zero? Yes, right? Because there are two parts. You have a capacitor C going to the output, and there is also a MOSFET. So we'll find the zero first. So if you take this MOS device separately, I'm ignoring R naught now. Apply a voltage VI and find out the condition when the output current goes to zero. Since the output node voltage is zero, what is the current flowing through the MOSFET? So VI is the gate voltage, source voltage is zero. What is the current flowing through the MOSFET? GMVI. And what is the current flowing through the capacitor? VI into SC. And both the currents are in the same direction, right? Both the currents are flowing in the same direction. So I can write GM plus SC into VI. I've added the two currents equals zero. So therefore, the condition for zero is at minus of GM by C. So what you have gotten here, this is a left of plane zero. You have gotten a left of plane zero. Okay, as opposed to a common source amplifier, we were getting a right of plane zero. Here it's a left of plane zero. Okay. So keep this point in mind. So this is a left of plane zero. So now if I write the transfer function for transconductance, the short circuit transconductance GM of S is given by GM. From this equation, I'll take GM common out. I'll get SC by GM. So this GM is your DC transconductance multiplied by the zero location. There are no poles here. So it will be 1 plus SC by GM. And the zero here, whenever I'm writing it in radians per second, omega z is radians per second, I don't care about the polarity, I'll write it as GM by C. When I write SZ, that captures the polarity, which will be minus of omega z. which will be minus of gm by c. So this is the notation we'll follow throughout the course from now on. Okay, so you found out zero, an example where there is zero in the right of plane as well, in left of plane as well. We took two examples, common source and common drain. We saw zeros in both these cases. The next step is to find the output impedance. If you want to find the output impedance, short circuit the input and find the value frequency at which your output impedance blows up to infinity. So you have RL here. So can you tell me what is your output impedance? So I'll have C coming in parallel with CL. So I'll remove this capacitance and write it as C plus CL. So what is your output impedance looking at this node? So can you tell me in terms of impedances? Can I say it is 1 by GM, that's your upward looking impedance, in parallel with RL, in parallel with 1 by S CL plus C, CL plus C. Okay, or you can also write it as DC impedance. DC impedance is 1 by GM parallel RL divided by 1 plus S CL plus CC, CL plus C into 1 by GM in parallel with RL. This is the expression you get for the output impedance. DC impedance, that it has only one pole because there is only one capacitor, resistor and capacitor in parallel, so you will get only one pole. Right? See, MOSFET offers a resistance of value 1 by GM. So I replace the MOSFET with a resistance of value 1 by GM. 1 by GM parallel R in parallel with the capacitance of value CL plus C. CL plus C. So you will get this. DC impedance is 1 by GM parallel R divided by 1 plus S into CL plus C into 1 by GM parallel R. So now your total transfer function will be plus GM into 1 plus S C by GM divided by 1 plus S CL plus C into 1 by GM parallel R. Numerator is also multiplied by 1 by GM parallel RL. You expand this term, you will directly get GM RL by 1 plus GM RL. And that's your DC gain. So this term here is your DC gain. So I've multiplied this with this. Then I'll have a zero, which will be at 1 plus SC by GM, right of left of plane zero, and a left of plane pole. Sorry, 1 by GM parallel RL. Okay, so here, even though there were two capacitors, there is only one pole here. So when you have two capacitors, at max, you will have two poles or two zeros. You have just one pole, one zero in the system. Okay, I'll just finish this discussion with one final discussion of a circuit, which is, let's say we have a circuit like this. This is VS, RS, and I've added a capacitor here. I've added a capacitor C here. If I added a capacitor C here, and let's assume we have a load resistance at the output. Now we have to analyze the zero of the circuit and poles of the circuit. I have two capacitors, so at max you can expect, I mean, let's assume there is an output capacitor as well. Now let's use the definition of a zero. Okay, what is the definition of a zero? For some finite frequency, the output voltage should go to zero. The output voltage here goes to zero. There are two ways in which the output voltage can go to zero. Either the output impedance here goes to zero at some frequency, or the current entering here, output current can go to zero at some frequency. Okay, output current can go to zero at some frequency. Can the output current go to zero at any frequency? What is the output current? That is same as the current that is input. The current that is input to this amplifier, it is same as that. See, whatever current enters here, the same current is going to flow. I mean, some part of it will go through the capacitance as well, but roughly the same current will be going here as well. So can you tell me, is there any frequency at which the current at the input can go to zero? You have a capacitance that is the only frequency dependent element. Okay, can it go to zero at any frequency? What is the looking in impedance into the source of this MOSFET? What is the looking in impedance into the source? That's 1 by GM. So I can reduce the circuit to something like this. I'll have Vs, Rs, a capacitor C, and an impedance of value 1 by GM. Now I'm asking you, the current flowing through this, can it go to zero at any frequency? See, for it to go to zero, what should be the value of impedance? Either one of them should be infinity, right? For it to go to zero, either one of the impedances has to be infinity. But can this RS go to infinity at any frequency? No. RS cannot go to infinity at any frequency. So therefore, the only other possibility is this one. Can this impedance blow up to infinity at any frequency? Can this impedance blow up to infinity at any frequency? Now look at it. You have a parallel resistor and capacitor. Yes, it can blow up to infinity. It can blow up to infinity if this impedance combination blows up to infinity. When does this impedance combination blow up to infinity? Minus GM by C, that's it. When minus 1 by GM becomes equal to 1 by SC, at that value of S, you get minus GM by C, this impedance blows up to infinity. So this will blow up to infinity, then your current will become zero. So now look at it. By using that condition, I could estimate the zero in the circuit. Okay, using this condition, we could estimate it is minus GM upon C, we get the zero in the circuit. Similarly, if you have, this is 1 by GM and this is C, this is the zero in the circuit, that's where the frequency where the current goes to zero, which means output will also go to zero. So the zero in the circuit is 1 plus GM by C. Next, I'll try to find out the pole, the location of the pole. Okay, the location of the pole. Remember, okay, I made a small mistake here. I made a very small mistake here. Okay, the mistake that I made here is this is the frequency at which the input current goes to zero, that which is fine. Okay, the frequency at which the input current goes to zero is 1 minus, S is minus GM by C. Now, I am interested in finding out the output current, which is the current entering the MOSFET. IS is the current entering the MOSFET. That is the point where I need to find out, right? IS is the current entering the MOSFET here. Can you tell me, if you know I here, which is the current entering the capacitor and 1 by GM, how will I find the current flowing through the MOSFET? So you have a capacitor C and you have a capacitor that's just a parallel division. You know the current I here. What is the current flowing through the MOSFET here? So that will be dependent on, it is just a parallel division. So that will be 1 by SC divided by 1 by SC plus 1 by GM. Okay, so you will get, so using that I can write it as GM by GM plus SC. So that will be GM by GM plus SC. That's the current that's going through 1 by GM. That's the current which will be going at the output. Now, yes, at some value of S, I naught becomes 0. At that value of S, I naught becomes 0. So now if I write IS here, IS is the current entering the MOSFET. IS is simply I is the input current times 1 plus, I'm going to take GM to the denominator, I can write it as 1 plus SC by GM. We saw that it's going to 0 at S equal to minus GM by C. But here, there is a pole at this point. So will that 0 appear at the output? The current I, this current I here, has a 0 at 1 plus SC by GM. So why will not the pole appear? What is happening in the system? The pole and zero are getting cancelled out. So this is an example of a pole zero cancellation. Okay, so I'll leave that out. Now the next question I'll ask you is that, is there any frequency at which Is there any frequency at which your current can blow up to infinity? Can I become infinity? Okay. Can I become infinity at any frequency? Can you figure that out? Can you try finding out any frequency for which I becomes infinity? Yes. So the condition is the total impedance here, the sum of the two impedances, RS plus this impedance should become equal to zero. If that becomes equal to zero, then VI, VS by zero will become infinity. So use this condition. So you get RS plus this impedance here, which is 1 by GM parallel 1 by SC becoming equal to zero. So you will get a condition RS equals minus of this, and you can easily solve that and get the condition for zero at, this will be at pole, because current blows up to infinity, the location for pole as 1 by C into 1 by GM parallel RS. 1 by C, you can solve it. This will be left of plane pole, so you will get this condition. Is that fine? You will get this condition where the pole is given by, can be derived using this condition where current blows up to infinity at a given value fs. Okay, so fine. I'll discuss this in more detail. We'll take a few more circuits in the next lecture and analyze and find poles and zeros. And then we will directly, now that we have a good understanding of poles and zeros in MOS circuits, we can analyze single stage and also multi-stage and differential MOS amplifiers, okay, from with capacitors in place. So we will be able to derive intuitively the transfer functions for more complex MOS circuits. Yes, so one of you are asking, yes, this is a left of plane pole. Yes, it is a left of plane pole.